Good morning, and welcome back to Lopes on Movies. My name is Joey, and today I am joined by frequent co-host, friend of the show, Kyle.
Hey, how's it going?
And not live from New York City, the one, the only, you love him, Connor.
Hey there, Joey, and welcome everybody for all your Super Tuesday coverage, where we'll, so far it looks like a strong night for Delaware's own Joe Biden, whose campaign has been resurrected the last few days, starting with his strong showing in South Carolina last weekend, and then receiving two key endorsements from Amy Klobuchar and Pete Buttigieg, and all eyes... All eyes will be on Michael Bloomberg and Elizabeth Warren to see if they will stay in the race. And now, Kyle, what do you think about the Super Thursday coverage? I mean, Tuesday.
Super Thursday.
No, Super Tuesday, sorry.
I've always been a really big Bloomberg guy. I think Bloomy's taking us to the top. And, you know, he won American Samoa, and he's going to keep winning.
I do think that he will likely have to drop out. I think his advisors will have to tell him that I'm sorry, Mikey, this is not going to happen. This is not going to happen.
Do they call him Mikey?
I don't think they call him Mikey.
Or do they call him Mayor Bloomberg?
I think they probably call him Mayor Bloomberg or Mr. Bloomberg.
I bet they still call him Mayor Bloomberg.
Oh yeah.
But
I do.
You know, this is a movie show.
Oh,
that's right. This isn't Lopes on Politics.
Lopes on Politics would not be a very good show. I'm going to tell you right now. Lopes on Politics would not be very insightful.
No, it would not.
So, do not expect that.
Obviously, this is a University of Delaware radio station that we record this on. And, yeah, so if you're a fan of Joe Biden... He's doing well.
I guess we'll see how well this
podcast.
We'll see how well this this episode ages.
we already dated it very strongly.
This is no doubt the day that this comes out, which is tomorrow. Biden had a really good day.
Okay. So. Anyway, what are we talking about here, guys? Okay, all right. Let's find our center here a little bit, everybody. Okay. Last week, I was in Boston for the PAX East convention, which is a gigantic gaming conference. So, obviously, I did not have any time to see any movies.
And Joey, you were doing that for the university, correct?
Yes. As part of the esports initiative we are doing here at the University of Delaware, which I'm heavily involved in. So I was networking with people in the industry. And, you know, just trying to make some connections and learn some things and bring back some ideas and all that good stuff. But obviously no time for movies when you're doing all of that. You know, you gotta be focusing on the convention.
Of course,
I'm sure Connor and Kyle, you as well, were both equally busy. And for that reason, you were not able to see any movies.
No, I didn't really do anything.
You know, I saw one movie, and it was an advanced screening that I cannot talk about.
Oh. Well, that doesn't really
like
help us much, does it?
Would you like
wait,
a review?
Wait, I got something.
Oh, okay, Kyle, go ahead.
Yeah, so I opened up Netflix on Sunday, and I saw the two popes right there staring at me, and I didn't watch it.
Both popes were staring at you?
Yeah. One after the other, just giving him the eyeball.
Boy. That's what it's called, right? Two popes?
Yeah, that would definitely creep me out. Did the eyes like follow you too? Like just
yeah. I bet they did.
Like the Mona Lisa.
I closed
Lisa,
the app
like just...
and they were still there.
Yeah. Okay. But Joey, you did something cool at PAX, right? You went to a panel with living legend and creator of Dexter's Lab and Samurai Jack, Genndy Tartakovsky. How was that? I was wondering.
This is true. So even though we don't have any movies we can talk about today, I can talk a little bit about the one of the panels I saw at PAX. As Connor said, with Genndy Tartakovsky. We've talked about him on the show before. We did an episode about Primal, the Adult Swim series that Genndy Tartakovsky was working on, which if you haven't heard that episode, strongly suggest you go back to our YouTube channel. You can find it just Lopes on Movies and watch that episode, because I think everybody needs to know about Primal. That's, you know, one of the most exciting things happening in animation today. Like, everybody should be watching that. The second season is currently in production, so you'll have your chance very, very soon to watch new episodes. But in the meantime, definitely got to seek out the first season, which aired not too long ago, just last year. Anyway, so they are making a Samurai Jack video game.
Ooh.
Probably am not going to play it.
Mm.
But it is very lucky that they're making this Samurai Jack video game, because it gave Genndy Tartakovsky and Samurai Jack writer, one of the writers on the show, Derek Bachman, a reason to be at PAX East, a gaming convention, which I had no idea they were going to be there until literally like the day before I went. I was just like looking through the schedule and saw, you know, Adult Swim Games panel. I was like, oh, I wonder what this is about. And I clicked the link and it's like, you know, Genndy Tartakovsky and Derek Bachman are the panelists. I was like, oh my God. I'm about to get to see Genndy Tartakovsky.
How was the showing for that panel?
Oh God, it was packed. It was like, wow. The room was utterly packed, and Genndy was getting hounded by fans before it started, trying to get like autographs and stuff. Like, I'm not gonna bother the guy, you know. That's just not the way I roll. But like, oh my God, it was unbelievable. I couldn't believe how many people were there, and I was really hoping it wouldn't be as well attended, because if there wasn't like a gigantic amount of people, there might have been a chance to like actually talk to him a little bit. But unfortunately, that opportunity didn't really present itself, so I didn't get a chance to like have a conversation with a man that I believe is one of the most exciting filmmakers working today, one of the absolute best people to watch out for, and somebody who's meant a lot to me personally, just because of how much Samurai Jack meant to me growing up and continues to mean to me to this day. So the panel was mostly about the game, but also just kind of about the series in general. A lot of stuff that I've heard before, like nothing like super insightful, because it's a general panel, you know. It's not like they're going, it's not like a deep dive into the mechanics of how they made the series and stuff, which is more of the kind of stuff that I'd be interested in. But nonetheless, it was still interesting, and I'm still sitting like, you know, 20 feet away from Genndy Tartakovsky and Derek Bachman. So it was really cool experience. Definitely you know, not something I was expecting, just a very pleasant surprise. If I understand correctly, Connor, you've been kind of rewatching Samurai Jack lately, haven't you?
Yeah, I watched it with my roommate. Yeah, he never saw it, and he remembered it as a kid, but then we watched through it and then watched the new season, which came out, I think, 2017, right?
Yes,
it wasn't that it? Yeah, so it was great, you know, and on rewatch, it's almost even better. So, you know, you it's just obviously, you know, the early episodes were all standalone mostly, and like just was a great way for them to tell whatever kind of story that they wanted with this character. You know, Samurai Jack, and then just did whatever they wanted with it. You know, gangster movie, noir film, you know, whatever they wanted, and it was great. And then the new season that came back, you know, and you got to see how they wrap up the story. Did you also say that they're thinking about doing more things?
Yeah,
with Samurai
Jack? At the panel, like Genndy hinted very strongly that, like, he said something like, you know, This game is one thing, and you know there's plenty more to come with Jack, although I don't have anything to announce at this time, you know. So like he was implying that, like, to him he kind of feels like the idea of Samurai Jack has really only just begun. And I kind of get that, because if you think about it, like when the series first aired, and he says this all the time, like when the series first aired, it had like a core audience, but it wasn't very large because it was always trying to find like its niche. But then over time, it just continued growing and growing and growing in popularity. And one interesting stat that he pulled up from like DVD sales people that he talked to were like, every month the Samurai Jack DVDs sell the same amount. It never goes down, right?
That's interesting.
So yeah, it's just the kind of thing that like it kept growing and growing, and people like kept asking him for years when he's going to end it, right? So Samurai Jack, in this moment, is more popular than it has ever been. So really, like, I could understand the feeling that's like, well, you know, now's the time to continue doing stuff with it, even though like the story ended and he doesn't have any obligation to continue doing anything with Jack, as far as I'm concerned. I feel like there's a sense that there might be more to do. I don't know exactly what they would do. I mean, personally, I don't think there needs to be any more Samurai Jack, Because I'll go to bat for anything Genndy decides to work on. Like, any original project that he's interested in doing, like a personal project of his, sign me up. Like, I don't need it to be a Samurai Jack thing, you know? Because I always say this to people, like, the thing that you like is not as important as the person making the thing that you like.
Yes.
So, like, the, you know, if you're a huge, like, a good example I always give is if you were a big fan of the show Veep when it was on for a while, the first four seasons were all directed by the same showrunner, Armando Iannucci. And then season five, he leaves the show to pursue other projects, and instantly the show was completely different. Like, you can't take away a creative lead from something and then have the thing be the same if you keep going with it, because it's like, that's the person that matters. That's the person that gave the thing what it was, right? And there's like varying degrees of that, where sometimes it's a group of people that matter more and sometimes it's a single person. But like, the point is, I don't care about intellectual property. I don't care about Samurai Jack itself. The fact is, Samurai Jack was made by a particular team of people working at the top of their game, making a particular thing. So I care about what those people want to make. I don't necessarily care about the Samurai Jack IP. You know what I mean?
Yes. So like, that's very counter to what things are nowadays. It's all about like the IP instead of like actual like director and creator. It's very different.
Blame video games for that, by the way. That's one of my theories, is that gaming culture kind of seeped into movie culture and ruined it. because gaming has always been that way, like at least for a while anyway. Like, gamers never knew who made the games they liked. Because gaming, generally speaking, like, you played games when you were younger, right? So all you knew is like Legend of Zelda, you knew Mario, you knew, you know, whatever the name of the franchise is. But generally speaking, like, other than like a handful of like big names, like, you know, Miyamoto or whatever, gamers never knew who made the things that they liked. They just liked the series or the franchise. And I feel like the same thing is kind of happening in movies now, where people like are more interested in the intellectual property than the people making the thing. So it's like, if Marvel announces like a Blade movie, like, people lose their minds over the fact that Blade's coming back, but like, They don't really care who's making the Blade movie. You know, it doesn't matter who's making the Blade movie. It could be any guy that, like, get off the street. Who cares, you know? Because the fans only care about the fact that, you know, the character that they like is coming back. So that's one of my big things, is that, you know, you follow people. You know, don't follow a franchise just because, you know, you fall in love with the characters or the things that the franchise does. Because let's face it, that came from a person. And if that person or that group of people are no longer there, then the thing is just an empty husk of what it was before, and you should be ignoring it anyway. So that's kind of my feeling on that one.
Which happened to Genndy Tartakovsky, actually. Like, he created Dexter's Lab, and then remember they brought Dexter's Lab back without him at the helm?
Yeah, that was weird.
Episodes were so good.
nice subversion there, Kyle.
Yeah, it was.
What's your favorite post Genndy episode of Dexter?
Oh, that short where his dad is playing golf, man, that was great.
Yeah, I don't think so. All right, so I have an idea of something that that got into my head. So you went to see Genndy Tartakovsky. I went to try to go see Kyle MacLachlan, who was doing like a line signing thing.
That's right.
And it was a very cold day, and by the time I got there, the line was way out the door, so I couldn't go to this free wine tasting to meet one of our idols, also Kyle MacLachlan, who's famous for being Detective Cooper on Twin Peaks.
Among other things. Jeffrey Beaumont in Blue Velvet, another David Lynch thing.
Sex in the City. He was the guy that, the husband that couldn't get it up in that show.
I've been there, brother.
Yeah. You know, one of something hilarious, he says that people in the city all the time will say stuff like that to him, like, good luck, you know, hopefully you can get it up this time. And then he just, like, it was a character, it was a show, there's no problem. which is pretty hilarious. He seems like such a great guy. I'd love to, you know, be able to meet him one day.
His social media presence
just
is really
thank him.
Nice.
Oh, it is. It's great. Yeah. He's excellent on social media. And he always, you know, brings up the Twin Peaks stuff. Yeah. But
of course,
going off of Twin Peaks, I was done by creator David Lynch, who, you know, one of our favorites. And so that brings me to, I have a recommendation for people.
Oh, you got a recommendation? Oh,
yes, boy. I do. On Netflix. And it kind of goes...
Two popes?
No, it's not the two popes. It kind of goes off of, you know, you were talking about Jack, and then I went to Kyle MacLachlan. It's a short by David Lynch called What Did Jack Do?
Oh, yeah, the monkey short.
It is 17 minutes, yeah. And I'll just tell you exactly what it is. It's in a lockdown train station, a homicide detective conducts an interview with a tormented monkey. And that's what it is. So it's great. Yeah, it's David Lynch, you know, talking to a monkey. Where you get amazing dialogue, I know why the chicken, crossed the road, and other things like that. It's great.
Oh, man. You see people are going to think that we're being ironic here, but, like...
No, David Lynch is serious. Amazing. This is the greatest thing.
This sounds great.
Yeah, I would highly recommend it to anybody. 17 minutes. There's a musical number in it. Oh, it's great.
Oh, man. If only I still had Netflix, but my free trial ran out.
Yeah. Kyle, what have you been watching?
Why, Lost, of course.
Lost?
What else would someone watch in the year 2020?
Definitely not Lost.
Lost was, probably the first show that I ever watched from the beginning to end. And it was like one of those first giant phenom, like, serialized shows.
Yeah.
Can you think of another one that was like even close to that? Like that level that Lost was, you know?
Game of Thrones.
Well, no. I mean, but Game of Thrones is after Lost. Like Lost was like the first one to do this.
Before that, no, definitely not. Like Lost is the original like TV serial drama that everybody like couldn't wait to tune in for. And I know people like if you've been around for a while, you'll get mad at me for saying that because I know there's like what is it, Hill Street Blues or whatever. It's like the super old ones, the old serials. But like
what's that show that takes place in Baltimore?
The Wire.
But the Wire, right. The point being, Lost
was a cultural phenomenon. Everybody was watching Lost, like literally everybody in the world. So like I don't know if I would say Lost is the thing that began the whole like you know quote unquote golden era of television thing. So I kind of feel like that was a little bit later. That was more like 2008 with like Mad Men and Breaking Bad and those shows. But like I feel like Lost was one of the first like majorly popular like recent TV serials that kind of like created the notion that this is something that maybe people would be interested in. Although funnily enough, I feel like Lost itself was the only show of its kind to really be successful. Because if you guys remember, like around that time, there was like 100 Lost clones that kept coming out. Trying to do Lost things and just like completely failing.
Well, actually, you know, I know something that's interesting about that though is right around when Lost was huge, in between there was also the writer strike that happened, and that killed a lot of shows too.
That's right.
Remember that? Yeah, that was a crazy. That was a crazy time.
It was a crazy time.
Yeah, a lot of good things that could have been that just never got their chance.
So how you been feeling about Lost, Kyle, watching it many, many years later? I haven't seen it since I was, like, a kid, I feel like.
Yeah, I think this was the first, like, amount of Lost I've watched since the finale. I don't think I've watched an episode since.
That is crazy.
I might have watched one here or there, but that's as far as I can remember.
Mm-hmm.
It's better than I thought, because in my mind, the show was really, like, stupid. And it still is kind of stupid, but like I don't know, I really in my head like the dialogue was really bad, the characters were really like generic and stupid, but in all honesty it's actually a pretty good show. Now I've only gone through two seasons and I know it gets a lot worse going
forward. That it does,
or at least it gets a lot more weird in a bad way. And yeah, I'm enjoying it. I'm gonna keep watching it, at least until it gets bad.
Yeah, so I think
everyone else does too.
Yeah, I think what you're doing, Kyle, is you're remembering back to how bad it got, because I'm pretty sure that the network demanded that Lost go on for longer than it was intended to.
I can 100% see that.
And like, it got very frustrating. And I'm gonna talk about something kind of similar to Lost in a couple of minutes when we're done with this.
Oh no!
But the biggest problem with Lost to me is, there's one thing to be said about opening opening doors and then not like solving like what the mystery is behind that door or whatever. And Lost did that with so many things. and yes. Not that they didn't resolve it, but they didn't. It didn't even matter, like there, like it at all.
Yeah,
like it, a lot it's of not those. Like it's not like watching like something that my favorite David Lynch does, where it'll be something that's open ended or it's something that there's not a real explanation, but at least it's interesting to think about and like mm-hmm. try to like analyze in your head what it could mean, what that means, or what mm-hmm. or just enjoy what's going on. Mm-hmm. But something like as like in Lost, putting in the numbers to prevent something from happening doesn't get a payoff. The numbers themselves, what were those? Like it was ridiculous, all these different mm-hmm. like things that they opened in Lost and it didn't resolve them. And it just, that along with the fact that they stretched out the show for longer than it really should have been. Mm-hmm. And then it used to be based on like flashbacks to like these characters who were stranded on the island. And then it turned into flash forwards and flash sideways and flash.
Oh God. Yeah.
And then it just got out of control and it just got, well, bad. So
I'm pretty sure Flash Forward was the name of one of those awful Lost clones.
I think it was actually. Yeah, you're right. I don't think that one made it.
Didn't Fringe last like a disturbingly long amount of time?
Fringe.
That one almost made it.
Yeah. I remember there. I don't remember when this one came out, but there was a show called Alcatraz. Do you remember Alcatraz? Yeah,
that's right.
With
wasn't Locke
face?
In that?
No, it wasn't Locke. It was the guy.
Nikolai, was it Costawaldo?
No, like, no,
no.
God, what's was he in name? That?
The big
guy in Lost.
Oh, Hurley.
Hurley. Yeah, Hurley was in it. Hurley was in Alcatraz.
I do remember this.
That I
don't think I watched Alcatraz.
I watched the pilot to Alcatraz, and I think that's the show that made me the cynical person I am today, because I hated it so much. And I think actually that's the show that made me hate J.J. Abrams, because that was like the first like obviously like J.J. was like a big name at that point because his name was all over Lost and like some movies that he had done. But that show was like heavily advertised from producer J.J. Abrams, creator of Lost. And I'm watching this and I'm like, oh my God, I cannot believe how incredibly terrible this is.
How could anybody who knows
what they're doing
Joey,
put their name
thing.
On
this? I feel like we should have a buzzer on right now, because I thought in our pre-show meetings, we've specifically said that no one would bring up J.J. Abrams.
Yep.
Because this would happen. This would happen. So come on.
Hey, hold it. J.J. Abrams was brought up in a roundabout way, but not in the way that you were intended, that we were thinking it would happen. So that's okay, as far as I'm concerned. I didn't talk about J.J. Abrams because of Lost. I talked about him because of Alcatraz.
Oh, stop with your little workarounds to talk about J.J. Abrams.
All right, so I want to talk about something.
Okay, no more J.J. Abrams.
Similar to Lost, and it came from one of the showrunners of Lost, who was Damon Lindelof. Remember that name?
The heck.
Yeah, that guy. So he made a show that came out on HBO called Watchmen.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, so I watched Watchmen with my roommate who wanted to watch it, and it's not good. It's not good.
Wait. All the people online that I was hearing from said it was good.
Well, so here's the thing that surprises me. By I don't know who your online circles are, Joey, but I did a little bit of research myself before the show, in the right now. And on Rotten Tomatoes, the critic score is 96, which, 96.
It's very good.
It's pretty good.
The audience score is 54.
Oh, ooh, that's not very good.
No, that's not very good. So I don't know what circles you're, what Reddit groups, dark web things you're on.
Yeah, I'm reading Watchmen reviews on the dark web.
Anyway, it's not good. I just, the writing is really, really bad. And it's similar to, your criticism with, your remembering of Lost, Kyle, where the dialogue is just cringeworthy. The performances are so flat. I think, and this is someone I normally like, but the lead of the show, Regina King, is just horribly miscast for this also.
Oof.
Which is such a big problem. I don't know if anybody's familiar with the story. It's I don't even know if I should even get into it, but it's an alternate history kind of thing mixed in with I don't want to say superheroes, but kind of what do they call them? Vigilantes or whatever.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. An alternate history thing. Like in this universe, President Nixon contracted superheroes to end the war, the Vietnam War. And then he kept getting reelected after. And this is now taking place. This is a version of Watchmen is now a modern times thing. and Robert Redford is president, and I'm like, ah, that makes sense. I could see that happening, you know?
Sure.
Yeah, you know.
Wait, like Robert Redford, like, the actor. Is president?
Yeah, he just becomes president. Yeah, he's just president. You know, I could see
good
it.
Good for him.
Yeah, I mean, I could see it. The one redeeming quality of the show that kept me, like, from not just turning it off, which I wanted to, actually. My roommate at least had the decency to fast forward through a lot of the scenes that I couldn't stomach.
Oh, you missed all the good stuff.
was Jeremy Irons is great in it. He is a very great actor, and his plot in the show is so strange that I enjoyed it. I don't know what other people think about it. I've read like no reviews. The only thing close to watching a review is looking at that Rotten Tomatoes score. Critic score 96, audience score 54. And if you ever looked at reviews for TV, if something is not like 100, it must be awful, because everything is always like,
yeah,
like top for
TV reviews are kind of like music reviews. It's like they're always good. Like, yeah, you're very rarely gonna find like a review of like an album, like a music album, that like is bad, like in the aggregate. Like if you look on like Metacritic and go to like the music section, like, everything is like above like 80, because like it, you know, it's music. People that like it are gonna like it, and people that don't like it aren't gonna listen or review it. Now, the same is kind of true of television. I feel like people just kind of, you know, give a pass to everything on TV, which is why this is a movie show. We don't talk about TV.
You're right. Can we talk about movies then? We have a couple of minutes left, right?
I mean, I would love to talk about movies, but I'm afraid that we're running out of time.
All right, well, hold on. We got to talk about Mulan.
Is there anything to talk about with Mulan?
So, but I heard just recently, like, the coronavirus might be a huge problem for Mulan.
It could be.
Yeah, because
more ways than one.
The film just got postponed in China, which is obviously something that they really need to happen. That needs to happen in China. Oh, yeah. The other thing that's that Mulan news is that they had to they removed a character who played like a general or something for Me Too movement concerns. So they just removed a character altogether.
I mean, this movie feels like it's compromised in a lot of ways.
It does, right? It seems to me like it needs to make a whole lot of money, or else this is going to be a horrible, horrible failure for the Disney Corporation. Which
Disney will be fine though. They don't need to worry about Mulan.
They're already making Snow White live action, and Sleeping Beauty live action, and
their revenue is guaranteed for the next decade, as long as they still have animated movies they can remake in live action.
So they are okay. So I have some more Disney news I want to talk about, and maybe speculation.
We'll make it quick because we're running out of time here.
Okay, sorry. Look at this. We had all these things to talk about. You know, started the show talking about, you know,
just
the politics.
The
politics, right? I have a seeking suspicion that the reason that Bob Iger stepped down is that he is working on his political career, and he will be running for president very soon.
Oh, boy.
If you're ready for that. Can you get... Awesome. Imagine what those ads are going to look like, you know?
I've already talked about this. Like, I feel like Bob Iger's entire strategy, I think you're right. I think he may very well run for president at some point. And I think that him running the Disney Corporation was all a strategy to get nerds to vote for him.
Oh yeah.
Because basically his entire campaign is going to be like, you know, be an Avenger, vote for Bob Iger. and all the nerds will say, "I love the Hulk. Here's my vote." All right, everybody, thank you for listening to Lopes on Movies. We will see you in the next episode, where we will actually talk about movies.
I don't know,
probably. If there's anything to see, I don't know. We'll be there. We got your back, don't you worry. Have a lovely rest of your morning.